flag this nation.
All right, next speaker is Ellie White. And Ellie, you're a high school student, right? Here in the state? Oh, just graduated, okay. Got future plans? Marshall University in the public, good. Physics and what?
Electrical.
Oh, good. You got the apple, right? I'm a tough one. And your talk is on open source radio telescopes, good. It's certainly very close to my heart too, so thank you for coming.
Thank you very much. So, one quick question, does this microphone work or is it?
It works, but it only goes to the internet.
It's internet.
You lose that range.
Project.
Okay, I'll try to. I should not be so good at that. So I wanted to talk about this group. Actually, Dr. Langston gave a really fantastic talk about that actually this morning. I'm following up such a great talk with Marielle. And so thanks very much to him for being us all introduced to what Open Source Radio Telescope is and what we hope to do.
I'm sorry, I'm an old man and I can't hear.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. I need to, learn to talk really loud, but I'm not very good at it, so.
Perfect, right?
Yeah. Pretend you're mad at us. Pretend you're mad at us and shout at us.
We'll be good.
All right, so the first thing I wanted to point out is that we have three names listed at the bottom of this presentation. That doesn't even begin to list all the people who've been involved with the project. That's just the people who actually wrote the presentation, so that's. I'll list a lot of our members at the end, but I just want to make sure you knew that these are just a couple of our members, and there's several others of us working on this. So with that, I'll start the presentation. So first of all, I'll talk a little bit about what is Open Source Radio Telescope. So as Dr. Langston was discussing earlier, the focus of this group is to be an open, collaborative, and free collection of radio astronomy, simple radio telescope designs, and curricula, software, just basically everything be open source and open to anyone who wants to learn about radio astronomy. So right now we are trying to provide plans and learning resources that are accessible to anyone who's interested in citizen science or student career in STEM, or any students ranging from middle school to grad school and beyond, and basically anyone of any age, so it's not limited by any means. So we also hope to foster an engaged community to promote discussions about radio telescope design, improving our designs, putting educational materials on the website. So we have a mailing list community that's very active and participates a lot in this kind of stuff. So that's what we are. So now I'd just like to mention, so that's the what, what's the why. So so many of you have done so much over your careers to try to foster interest in STEM among students, either through your radio astronomy interests or through other parts of your careers. So that's what we're trying to do too. We hope to inspire students to pursue careers in STEM related fields by exposing them to these challenging, engaging projects that they can get involved with and have real-world experience in doing. But it's a little bit different from like a typical program. We don't want to necessarily introduce them to these concepts in a dry or abstract way. We want to introduce them to it in a way that's very imaginative, engaging, and fun, which is radio astronomy. So radio astronomy has an imaginative appeal that goes beyond a lot of other ways that you present these engineering topics. So we hope that to use the hook of radio astronomy to get the students interested in fields like programming, engineering, practical skills like that, in addition to physical science and computer science, a number of different fields. So in addition to developing those knowledge of the STEM fields, we also want to develop skills that go alongside with that, develop in tandem, such as collaboration, communication, problem solving, critical thinking, all those skills that can contribute to a successful career in any whatever field you choose, ranging from art to science to anything you go into. So, but maybe most importantly, what we really want to do, this is is a little bit more abstract than the last couple of topics, but I think just as important. We want to help students rediscover their love for learning and just find what they're most passionate about, what they love to do with the rest of their life, whether that be in science or engineering, math, whatever, or any other semi-related field. We just want to help give these students the experience and opportunity to learn what suits them best and what they really like. So there are a lot of STEM education initiatives out there, which is a great thing, and the OSLT is just one more. So I wanted to talk a little bit about what makes this a little bit different from other groups. So over the past several years, many programs have been developed, including some focus on physical science and astronomy, like the Pulsar Research Laboratory or the Zooniverse Online Citizen Science Project. And in addition, there's also been a lot of projects geared more towards the engineering side, like Lego Robotics or Raspberry Pi. And what we hope to do with OSRT is to bridge the gap between these programs and to draw together students who may have an interest in physical science but also have an interest in engineering. So obviously, all these programs are fantastic for them to be involved with, but then in addition, have this one to kind of bridge over to different interests. So the projects that we, another thing that's a little bit unique, and some other programs are like this, but OSRT also makes our projects available for both classroom and individual use. So whereas some projects might be only suitable to use in a classroom setting, or for an individual, OSRT can be either used by individual or classroom. So, so that's sort of a summary of what OSRT is. So now I'll talk a little bit about what we're currently working on, the two projects that we're doing. We have two main projects that have been pretty well developed, and one of them is the Brand Antenna, which Dr. Weinstein went on to talk about at length and really excitingly about earlier. Another one was the Loop Antenna, which is capable of detecting solar flares by monitoring the signal strength of very low frequency submarine communication signals, which I'll talk a little bit more about here in just a minute. So similar to the SuperSit design a little bit. What we're doing right now is we're developing instructions and information about these projects and we're uploading them onto our website. The ultimate goal is to develop kits of these both of these projects to develop, to distribute to students in some way. And so we're actually, the Loop Antenna kit is well on its way to development, as I believe the Horn Antenna is also kit is being developed well, so that's very exciting. We have been in contact with some students who are interested in having a kit doing these projects, so we're just trying to get things started. And so that's kind of where we are with that. So these projects are all on all some of the different tools we've been discussing through this conference, including software-defined radio dongle and green radio software. So it's all open source or commercially available materials. Are easy for students to get even if they don't have a kit. So the first project that I'll talk about, mainly because this is a project I've been almost heavily involved with, is a small loop antenna. So this antenna is extremely simple to build. It's not very expensive, roughly in the neighborhood of $100. It can be used by anyone from middle school or high school level, really beyond that. High school, university level would be appropriate for it. It might even be adapted to use at the elementary level as well. The middle of high school is the main target audience. So the point of the loop antenna, as I mentioned a minute ago, is to detect solar flares. So I'll just briefly go over how it does this. I'm sure a lot of you have seen this graph before, so I won't take too long with it. But so when you have solar activity that's going on, you have solar flares approaching the Earth, that causes the layer in the atmosphere called the ionosphere to become more ionized. And what this basically does is it causes the very low frequency radio signal to bounce off a lower layer of the ionosphere than normally would. So since it's bouncing off at a lower point, it doesn't travel as far to reach your receiver, which means you see it as a signal brightening. So basically, if you just monitor the signal over time, you'll see a big spike when you have solar flares. So that's what we're looking for. That's what we hope to detect. So to do that, we had to design pipeline for loop antenna, determining how the different components would be necessary to make this detection. This was partially based on the design of the book that radio astronomy found Jeff Ashley. So of course you have your antenna, the loop structure, which the signal from the antenna is fed to a tuning circuit, which basically just tunes the amplifier signal. I don't really know what that means. So I'm not going to explain it. So which then is then that signal, which is at 24 kilohertz, is transmitted to an up converter, which mixes the signal with a 125 megahertz local oscillator frequency, which basically allows the software-defined radio dongle to process these signals and read it into our GNU radio flow graph. And GNU radio basically performs digital signal processing steps and records our data, which we then save and can process later with the secondary Python program that plots bandpass plot as well as a time series plot, which is the one that we use to look for solar flares. So, just briefly discuss the physical construction of loop and a couple other parts of loop. So it's really simple to build, and really simple and cheap to build. It's just made out of PVC pipe with about 24 to 26 turns of 20 gauge wire. That's really based more on how much you can get off the spool or than any complicated measuring ideas. So you guys can probably tell me that I need to be more precise about that, or maybe it doesn't matter. So that's the loop. So the tuning amplifying circuit that's used with this antenna that we hope to produce several of to go market is was developed by J.D. Nelson and Steve White at the observatory. They built the circuit. I've been testing it over the past couple weeks. We've been through several iterations with the circuit board. This is probably round two or three of the circuits we've developed. So it's tuned to 24 kilohertz, the frequency of the very low frequency station in Cutler, Maine. And the components that are used to amplify the signal are offnets. So that's going to tune the signal enough to make a good solid detection. So I will talk really briefly about this. I think I showed this slide also last year, but I just wanted to show it again for anyone who might have not been here, because I thought it was kind of interesting to see the differences between these two programs. So initially when I was starting this project, I used SDR Sharp. Then I started learning about the new radio program. So I wasn't sure which one to use. So I started experimenting with both, and I kind of figured out which one would work better for what. So the benefits to SDR Sharp is that it's really easy to build. There's almost no overhead. It's pretty much plug and play. But the inconvenient thing is that the signal recording was a little bit tricky for me for what I was trying to do with my Python program. It was not, the data files were really big and not very easy to manipulate. So with the new radio, the pluses are that it's very easily adaptable by the user. So you can use the new radio to visualize your data, to save it as a file format that's not too big or not too unwieldy. The only issues with new radio are that it does have a little bit of a bigger learning curve. It's a little bit harder to use. And the displays are a little bit harder to see, but not significantly. So in the end, what I did was I just used SDR Sharp as a diagnostic tool, and ended up using new radio to do an actual signal processing. Okay, so I'll just go over this briefly. Digital signal processing with GNU radio. So this is a really great, from an educational perspective, this is a great way to teach students about digital signal processing, about electrical engineering, about how, when you detect a signal, how it gets from the physical space to a graph you see in a computer. So GNU radio, one of the things that I really like about it from an educational standpoint is it lets you see all these steps plotted out. So you can actually, this is very adaptable, you can fiddle with different blocks, you can put new ones, take them away, experiment to see what works and what doesn't. So this also teaches students about just different concepts like complex numbers, Fourier transforms, because those are all the steps you have to put your signal through to get a vegetation. So that's, and there you can see all the different kind of parameters I put into the photograph to make it more appropriate. So now that I've kind of walked through the loop antenna process and what we did with it, all that stuff, so I wanted to show you kind of the end result of all this work. This is actually taken with the original design of my loop antenna. I haven't taken enough data with the new one to determine if it to detect any solar flares, but this data was taken last September. And the new antenna should be better than the old one, so this is with the old and not approved version. So you can see this is a time series graph, and you can see interesting spikes in data at different points. This is a time period of known high solar activity. So I purposely turned on my antenna during that time to see if I could get anything, and sure enough, it appears that I did. Now it would be better to have a longer baseline of time to be sure that this is solar flares, not some kind of interference. But the pattern of the how it sort of swoops up and then spikes sort of matches the diagrams I've seen of real solar flare data, so I tend to think maybe it was a real detection. And another good quality here is that you can see the sunrise and sunset signatures in the data, so that means it wasn't completely swamped out with interference. You can still see the natural areas that it's supposed to be. So that was kind of promising, and hopefully this is something that students can reproduce. This is a really simple project to build. I mean, it took me over a year to completely finish, but that was because it was a learning process for me. If we have all this stuff packaged up and easily available to students and have their teachers, train their teachers on how to use it, then it should not take that long. So it's the trial and error that kind of took the time. So now I won't go into too much detail about this because Dr. Lansden told you about all the details, and I'm not the expert on the Horn antenna. But I will briefly just discuss it from my standpoint as just what it means to SRT. So the Horn antenna is obviously quite a bit more complicated than the loop antenna. It gets more in depth, and so the electronics aspects is helpful in terms of introducing concepts like beam width, different things, mapping, things you wouldn't get with a loop antenna. It's a little bit more expensive than a loop antenna because it has more probes involved, which means it's a little bit higher quality. So it's definitely a step up from a loop antenna. This project is particularly well suited, I think, to high school, university level, potentially middle school as well. This is a great project too. I'll just briefly go through these slides. So this is a similar flow graph I made up for the Horn antenna. So you can see this was our original electronics design, but I've since learned that this is kind of a modified, a lot of these electronics that are replaced with one low noise amplifier, which is hopefully simpler and cheaper to implement. And so that's I've heard of extremely high quality amplifiers, so that will hopefully be part of the kits that we've developed with this Horn antenna. So like with the loop antenna, the data from the Horn antenna is converted from analog to digital using a software-defined radio sample. It's also processed using new radio and results in a data graph. So the idea concept behind the 21 centimeter horn is, of course, mapping H1 in the Milky Way. And of course, it's perfect for high school undergraduate students to construct. The skill level required is directly matched to students of that age group. And as mentioned before, I think maybe this price is off a little bit from what I heard from Dr. Langston this morning, but it's a bit more expensive and a little bit more complicated than loop antenna, which just means, so in my mind, what I feel like is that the loop antenna is a great place to start, and as you progress up, to develop more skills and learn more complicated practical skills like more complex soldering and stuff like that. So that's on my course. So the horn was constructed out of wood stand, foam board horn. was, so again, Dr. Langston went in over this in great, very helpful until this morning. So that's sort of, you can get a feel for, that's what inside the home looks like, and that's the original design for the So and then you see, I don't have the flow graph here, but a lot of you saw this morning. So here's a graph of the H1 line. So it's successful detection with the high antenna. So this is a really exciting project as well. There's a lot of potential that this project has for mapping clearly and different projects down the road, which I look forward to working on. I'll talk a little bit more about future projects here in just a minute. And of course, this is the same graph as last time, so I think really like it's really neat. So now I'd like to talk a little bit about future projects, and some of these may sound a little bit far-fetched, but hopefully with time and with more work, we can get them to the point where they're solid plans. Right now, they're just kind of being considered. So the first one actually is in progress, which is the H1 digital telescope. So I'm actually working on constructing a 10-foot satellite dish on my backboard. I hope to record my results with that as I go and kind of keep it uploaded to the website. And then hopefully at some point we can develop that also into either a kit or just a set of instructions for students to use to develop skills in learning about reflector dishes and that kind of thing. So this next one is one of my favorites. It's one I just heard about, so I'm still kind of new to the concept, but several members on our mailing list have been discussing the concept of possibly building on baseline astrometer of 3D coronal reflector antennas to potentially use to detect cosmic deuterium. So I think there's only been maybe one detection of cosmic deuterium, and it was by the MIT Haystack Observatory. And they were able to do that because they just used, I think, some cross-type or something like that to do extremely long duration time and detect cosmic deuterium. So that was a neat project to consider in the future that OSRT might pursue. And finally, another project that involves the horns that has been discussed and talked about over the past couple months is VLBI with horn antennas. So that would basically just be a system of connected horn antennas that we could use to maybe do some research on fast radio bursts. One thing that we have determined with that is that we either need a really, really large number of the horns, and probably in addition to that, we need like a good-sized dish to also collaborate with those observations. So still looking into that, seeing how feasible it is. But all these ideas are kind of in the development phases. We're excited to see where they go, and that's where I'd like to go with my next slide. We wanted to talk to you guys about this today because we know that you're all extremely well acknowledged in terms of radio astronomy, in terms of outreach. So we're really interested to have any feedback that you would have. If you'd like to get involved with the project, we're really excited to hear your input and see what new ideas you have, what you could bring to the table. There are lots of ways to get involved, ranging from just checking out our website to contributing to our wiki and getting involved with the mailing list. So you can see all the different options here. Our website is www.opensourceradiotelescopes.org. And on that website, we link to our wiki, which you can see is a little bit less polished than the website, but it's a great place to put developing ideas that will then be migrated to the website. So if any of our teachers, either at the middle school, high school, university level, or even elementary school, feel free to please contact us about maybe building one of these projects with your students. We're very excited to get new people involved and see what new things they can do with their schools. So just let us know if you'd like to do anything like that. Join our mailing list. We have a very, very active community with lots of different participants from a variety of backgrounds, lots of great new ideas, and we're always talking about great cool stuff. So the point of the mailing list is to serve as both the discussion place as well as a place for students to go to ask questions for people who would be able to answer So if you're interested in having these discussions as well as helping out students, then please do join our mailing list. I will say that at some point, we hope to migrate the mailing list to more of a forum-type format, which would be email integrated, so it should be pretty similar. So also, you can contact one of us directly. You can see our emails there, or you can also talk to me afterwards. Get my card or whatever. And then finally, I'd like to list the people who have been involved in this project. There are a lot of them. Hopefully, I haven't left anybody off. If I have, I apologize to everybody. I very much appreciate it. So all these people have been involved in the different projects and the project as a whole. So just thanks to everyone for everything they've done. Just really appreciate it. So with that, I'll just say thank you. Say if you have any questions, I'm all ears.
You made a reference to Zooniverse and some kind of web. What is that?
So that's actually an online project. It's basically a collection of several projects. So there are projects ranging from classification of galaxies using photographs to identifying contours of radio jets to a variety of biology and actually particle physics related projects. It's basically for anyone who wants to participate, not just students, it's for adults too. It's just a way for people to get involved in citizen science in a really simple way. So there's no, I don't know that any of those projects really involve a lot of hands-on work. It's mostly like online, like data processing type stuff, data analysis. But it's a really great program, especially for people who are interested in getting into one of the fields of science that are on this project. So it's Zooniverse. It's basically like Zoo combined with universe, so that's looking for it. It is really cool. Anybody can participate. So I have a lot.
The deuterium project, what wavelengths and frequencies?
So to be totally honest, I have not really gotten that far yet. this was just brought up actually a couple days ago on the mailing list. And it wasn't my idea, so I was just like, oh, guys, it's not really cool, so I just stuck on my presentation. Yeah.
Sorry, I want to say it's 327 megahertz, but where you missed
it. Yeah, that's right.
It's 327 megahertz.
Cool.
327.
Yeah. Any more questions?
I have one out of curiosity. Are you able to detect solar flares only during the day?
No, that's a great question. We can actually detect them at night too, and in fact, I believe these were detected during the night.
Okay. So those are actually detected in the middle of the night and in the morning. So they can be detected throughout the day.
Okay. Thank you.